Thank you very much. And the Olive Center was established about 10 years ago. Our goal was to do for olives what UC Davis did for wine, which you really could boil down to improving the quality, expanding the production efficiency, and increasingly promoting environmental sustainability. And so I very much valued our collaboration with Professor Mayates at LU and all the friends that we've collaborated with here in Greece. And part of the thinking in doing so is to see if we can help bring back some benefits for our faculty at UC Davis, as well as our producers in California. And hopefully, by our involvement, we can provide some of those same benefits here in Greece. So I'm going to talk about olive oil in the U.S. And selling olive oil in the U.S. And even though California, if it could, would love to be able to provide all the olive oil that Americans consume, at the current time, they produce about 6% of just the extra virgin grade. There's very little of other olive oil grades produced in California, a little bit, but mostly it's extra virgin. And so 94% of what we consume in the U.S. needs to come from somewhere else. And Greece is a major supplier, Italy, Spain, Tunisia. But how can Greece get a bigger share of the dollar from the Americans? How can you get more of those coming over here? And so that's what I would like to talk a little bit about. There's a big challenge in this because consumers are splintered increasingly into smaller and thinner slices, different demographics. At the same time, the advertising platforms have multiplied. And increasingly, we are distracted by phones and technology and everything else. So how do you break through to get to people in this kind of environment? And I don't have all the answers, but I hope to get you thinking about some ideas in which to break through and all the distractions and to reach this very large consumer audience. So I talked to some folks at UC Davis about this, and one of our professors who understands consumer behavior told me that you really need to ask these questions. What do they know, the consumer, and where do they get their information, and who do they trust? So you need to start with those basic questions. One thing that we did in terms of what do they know is UC Davis provided a survey a few years ago of American consumers to find out what they knew about olive oil and why did they buy it. And what we found was that the top reasons why people would choose olive oil over other types of oil is flavor and health. By far the top two reasons. For olive oil consumers, price did not factor quite as high. But there was some other data that was done more broadly about consumer behavior and purchasing behavior and health. And this was a survey that's done every year. This is the data from last year by the International Food Information Council Federated Foundation, which does an annual food and health survey. And they found similar taste, price, and health. Is that right? Healthfulness. So those, you can say pretty confidently that these are the factors that people will be considering if they want to eat more healthy food. And specifically, olive products, olive oil, table olives, and whatever else we can develop. Also, there was a study that we did at UC Davis where we looked at a smaller audience of consumers to find out what did they like about the flavor profile. And we segmented these consumers into three groups. The largest group actually liked the defective flavors, rancidity, fustiness, and I would attribute that to the prevalence of off-flavored olive oil in the American market. We had done a study about 6 years ago, which found about two-thirds of the oil did not meet the extra virgin standard, meaning that it had some defective flavors. So, but you can also see from that chart that about a quarter of the consumers we studied liked the robust oils, which tend to be the ones with the high polyphenol content, bitter and pungent. And then there was another segment of about 30% that liked a wide range of different oils. It could be defective, it could be bitter and pungent, it could be something else. And then also about the consumer, about what do they know, when you ask them how do they define a healthy food, they first cite that it's a food that does not contain certain ingredients. So those could be preservatives, or in the United States, many people are concerned about the consumption of high fructose corn syrup, which is a sweetener used very broadly in the United States. So it's interesting that they would define a healthy food by what it does not contain. But if you look at all the other elements here, this could fit very well olive products. Extra virgin olive oil, which is essentially a minimally processed fruit juice. You could look at, it's good for you. It does have any artificial ingredients. It's natural. All of these really count in favor of consumers embracing extra virgin olive oil or any naturally produced olive product. And which of the following would motivate you to make an effort to change your eating habits? And you can see in these, say, top three answers here, they're answers that also are consistent with what many studies are finding out about extra virgin olive oil, or olive oil consumption generally. It's for people who want to lose weight. They wanted to protect their long-term health. They wanted to have more energy and feel better. The studies show that a Mediterranean diet, and in particular extra virgin olive oil, can do all of these things. So you're already starting with a pretty good base with the American consumer. In terms of the question of who do they trust, this really breaks down by age group. But people who are from 50 to 80 years old, they would cite these two top choices here about a registered dietitian or nutritionist or their personal physician. Those are the people that they trust. And so if you're trying to promote something, getting a nutritionist or a physician on your side seems like a good course to follow. But for younger people, they look at different sources that they trust. And for the consumer between 18 and 35, they would trust a fitness professional, or a food blogger, or a farmer. So it depends on which demographic you're going to look at. And as I said, we're slicing these demographics thinner and thinner as to how you approach the demographic and who you get as your spokesperson. And then the question of where do they get information? You can see in this chart that for about half the American consumer, if they're looking for information about health, healthy food products, they look to the label. And in the United States, we are not as strict about what goes on the label for olive oil as it is here in Europe. So there's quite a bit of flexibility that you would have in how you describe the oil. You can describe flavors, you can provide some romance, you can do lots of different things to try to capture the eye of the consumer. But the other things on this chart are also in the control of the producer, at least a couple of them. The company website, you can control that. A QR code, if you had that as part of your sales display, it could go to your website. Or a third-party website, it could be a news source or some other source. You can also seek to get those kind of stories written about your products. So in all these things, what the studies tell us in terms of trying to influence consumers is you need to keep it simple. And they don't really need to know how you got to a conclusion scientifically. They just need to know what the health benefit is. So that is very good to keep in mind, is to keep your messaging simple. And I actually have a few examples that I wanted to show you that I took last year off the shelf. Here's one, you know, very large bottler, Carbonell, out of Spain. And you can see as part of their logo, they've got the shape of a heart. They say it's heart healthy. And they have information that you can read on the back of the label describing what the rationale they can say, they can provide this health claim. And it's based on a Food and Drug Administration health claim that is rather weak. It's not as strong as the claim you have here in Europe. But it does allow them to put a very simple message on the front of the label. Unfortunately, a lot of other oils, other than olive oil, are putting the same health claim on the label. So you're going to be finding that you've got some competition in that respect. This is canola oil. It's also heart healthy. Corn oil, turns out that's heart healthy too. Soybean oil, in Spanish at the top, and in English it says pure soy, pure health. So soy oil. And this is high-oleic safflower oil with a nutritionist on the hang tag who looks very persuasive that this is a very healthy product and you know, has all kinds of benefits for attractive people. So this is what your competition is doing, at least in some places in the United States, is they are keeping it simple, they're talking about health, they're using a nutritionist, and you may want to consider doing more of that to reach this segment of the market. So here's the summary of what I just said. You know, what do they know? Olive oil is healthy. They base their decisions on taste, price, and health. Some segments of the consumers like a bitter and pungent oil. Who do they trust? 50 to 80, they like nutritionists, personal physicians, 18 to 35, farmers and fitness professionals, and bloggers. And then where do they get their information? Primarily labels, but also all third-party and company websites and QR codes. Now, I looked at some information from the Nielsen Corporation, which tracks consumer behavior in the United States. In fact, they track consumer behavior and marketing information globally. And they released a global survey last year looking at food and health. And it was interesting to look at that because there is some parallels to what I just described. They're talking about successful strategies for marketing to consumers based on health. You can see, keep it simple, make it convenient, cost-effective, and tasty. So some easy package to enjoy olive oil or table olives or olive products. It might be some other kind of product. And one of the other products that you might consider is don't ignore the indulgence categories. You know, people like sweet things. And so you imagine, even though this might be distasteful for a lot of us who appreciate an extra virgin olive oil, you might consider the possibilities of a high phenolic olive oil with a high phenolic chocolate. I think that would be good. I've had that actually before by a producer in Italy. It was really fantastic. Or maybe a salty snack. It could be the salt remaining from table olive curing, the brine that you dehydrate. Put that in a salted nuts and adding some nutrition. So don't ignore the indulgence categories. And then finally, that the people who tend to spend the most and are the most motivated to buy healthy food products are those who are suffering from ailments or are older consumers. So keep them in mind as you think about ways to approach the American market. And so, I just want to say again that breaking through is not easy. There's distractions. The consumers are sliced up into thin segments. There's multiple media platforms for advertising. Mass advertising has shrunk in terms of its effectiveness. And I can't tell you all the ways to get there, but I hope I've given you some ideas on how you might think creatively on how to approach it. And I'd also like to say again that I appreciate very much our collaboration with Professor Mayatas and Nelyu. And I think through their leadership, what we're going to find, and I hope this happens for all of us, is an era of bold recovery, better health, and a brighter future for all of our